Internet is not enough. In 10 years, we need something new. And why is that? I think we can do much, much better. We have sustainable development goals, Agenda 2030 to solve, where digitalization and internet will help. We have national security needs, which are big societal problems with the deglobalization currently ongoing. I think it would work for kind of normal business development, normal social media development, internet would do. But internet, if you combine all these different use cases in these four areas, as an example, internet is today not safe enough, it's not fast enough, neither in terms of, and then I mean in development pace, not fast enough, and not secure enough. All this is due to fragmentation, and I think over my 30 years in telecommunication, I've never seen a bigger need in order to speed up things to go back to the basic drawing table. This fragmentation also makes us very proud to be here today, because I think in this audience, you have the collective knowledge how to solve these challenges that we stand in front of. I say, have the competence, it's more a matter of how we're doing it and combining our combined knowledge. When I started my telecommunication career, I started during my KTH student in a call center, helping people to connect their, at that time, computer PC with their telephone landline, day and night. That was a challenge at that time, but a big step forward. Later in the career, I was leading a team who solved the challenge to make Spotify, listen to Spotify music over 2G. So the combination of a new application over an infrastructure in terms of 2G. That was something unique at that time, because everyone was waiting and thinking that we need to wait for 3G for that to happen, which were some years ahead. So in a, not overnight, but almost overnight, we got an advantage, both Spotify, because you could listen to it in your phone, not only in your computer, and you can do it already here and now, wherever you were in the geography. That was a big step at that time as well. I was also leading the first 4G commercial launch here in Stockholm, the world's first 4G launch, 2009. That, in combination with some new innovative thinking around business models for mobile data, which was differing from the fixed internet. And definitely, I don't know if you, all of you in this audience remembered that you, in the beginning, paid per megabyte and consumption of data, and we got into this bucket model or free data type of models. That was a big step at that time. That, in combination with the arrival of the smartphone, I think that has impacted all our lives. I've had different CTO roles where, of course, worked with innovation and new stuff, but I can say the biggest learning from that period and time was handling and management of crisis. I've been part of a crisis management of a shutting down the airport, terrorist attacks, and also earthquake that has closed down a whole country. In all these cases, telecommunication services and internet services were crucial both to help, to calm down, but also it's so clear what could have worked better if there were more resilient telecom infrastructure in place. Currently, I'm reading a 5G and cloud industry innovation program. We work together with a lot of different industry companies and societal bodies to innovate and build new solutions for 5G and cloud. it's pretty clear there that if we had the use cases that we see today, development will go on, so to say. But there are thousands and thousands and thousands of different use cases that if you combine them, you can do something differently, also helping solving national security problems and Agenda 2030 problems. And it's also pretty clear that the technology is not the limitation. It's really how we set up the technology. If you take telecommunication and IT, internet type of services, you can basically split them into three different areas. One is a device. One is some type of brain in terms of a cloud, where you compute and store your data and apps in the phone, and then you need to connect it. These three areas develop independently today. Maybe not as a software end-to-end, but from an infrastructure point of view. If you take the phone as an infrastructure, there are a lot of different trends impacting that today. One is that it's falling apart, where the phone comes in the shape of eyeglasses, a watch, or a car, or a drone, or something else. In some of these cases, that also means that there is less place for processing power, which means that you need to put a lot of the compute and storage in the cloud. Is that time critical, sensitive for data? You need to move it closer to the cloud, closer to the device. The other trend, if you take it then from national security point of view and mission critical, is that if you see, for example, a guard today that has a very important task, take that as just an example, he probably have 3 or 4 or 5 different devices on him for communication only. One for doing what you can normally do through a smartphone to keep up with the development pace of what hyperscalers do and the telecommunication business is providing. One as a walkie-talkie to be able to communicate in case something happens, to be able to communicate in its closest environment. And one satellite phone, for example, then, if everything breaks down to get contact with the outer world. 3 different equipments that could be consolidated into one. So a lot of different trends. So the variety of devices is exploding. On the hyperscaler side, or the cloud side, it's not a competition anymore between the different cloud suppliers to build the biggest data center. It's a competition who can distribute their data centers out in the geography. And that then also puts a lot of requirements on the connectivity between the device and where you want to do your compute and store. And that's a third leg that needs infrastructure modification in order to support such a development. So if you take from a software perspective, with the development pace of probably a quarter maximum, you take it with infrastructure, and I can say then from a telecom communication perspective and the connectivity infrastructure, I think the longest contract that I ever signed was lasting till 2047. That's almost 30 years away. And if you then start to look back of how the communication systems and what we had 30 years back looked like, so these infrastructure investments is so crucial that we do in the right way in order to meet up with the development and to optimize it. And that's a big challenge in today's world. It's only not only an industry problem. In this innovation programs that we drive now, there are other infrastructure from other industry players, other infrastructures, which also has this slow pace in combination with this fast development. And my full belief is that we can do something better than today if we, and there I think if you take the different roles that we can have in a room like this or an audience like this, I think the academia will play a large role as an independent partner in defining, with their knowledge, to define that what will this combined software, infrastructure, architecture, and system look like. So some type of system of internet systems. Having said that, what I meet in my daily life is that there are a lot of different experts in these, only in these three different areas, that has their knowledge, that think that their area is the most important one. So I think from academia, what I would like to see is a bit of a step back and understanding the bigger picture. What is crucial to drive this development faster, not only to learn more about your area and how that fit into a bigger context. As companies and businesses, we of course need them to adopt to new rules and regulations when it comes to national security and all meet up with the sustainability goals. For that to happen, I think there is a big need not only to look on business cases for individual steps, but also take a larger context of what you are operating and doing currently. And that's very scary, because that might lead to disruption, might lead to consolidation. So I think we have some years in front of us now of these type of activities due to all these tens and thousands of different use cases that we are expected to support as an industry. From governmental and public bodies, I think the expectations, and when we work in innovation and development programs, it's quite a long lead time. You form an idea, you apply, you wait for an answer, and then you run your project. And then there's a next round, and a next round, and a next round. I think we all need a more solid base in terms of a common vision of what academia has created, a system of internet systems, for different supporting different industry needs, different society needs, and then start to drive towards that vision. Today, there's too many projects that is based on your own learning, so to say. And that's why I think you come in, because I'm convinced, as I said then, that in this room, I think the competence is there, but it will require a lot of trust among you. It will require a lot of creativity among you and a lot of tough decisions touching your own field and competence in this area. Thank you.